Right. Well, hello and welcome, everyone. My name is Dr. Lisa Waters-Vern, and I'm the Vice President of Programs at Benetech. I'm looking forward to the conversation today from these inspirational speakers who are working to advance education equity in New Mexico. At Benetech, we believe that equitable access to education is a human right, and we work to level the playing field for people of all abilities. Benetech is committed to supporting students and schools and cities across the U.S. We have taken a national approach as well as a very targeted local approach and have hired outreach coordinators in Albuquerque, New Mexico, Detroit, Michigan, Clark County, Nevada, Atlanta, Georgia, Memphis, Tennessee, and soon to be adding Baltimore, Maryland. These outreach coordinators work with the local community, educational organizations, and school districts. So really they're looking at the students that they serve from all angles and not just from the schools. They provide training and support to help educators, as well as clergy members, tutors, families, and others to provide accessible learning materials to students with dyslexia, visual impairments, or cerebral palsy, and other reading barriers. Joining us today is Sarah Caswell, who's based in Albuquerque. With her are representatives of local organizations that have partnered with Benetech for some time. It's my pleasure to introduce the following. Lisa Harmon Martinez, the Director of Learning by Doing at Future Focus Education. Kitty Edstrand, Innovation Development and Research Coordinator at the New Mexico School for the Blind and Visually Impaired. And Janae Menicucci, Coordinator for New Mexico Universal Design for Learning. They are all working to improve the educational outcomes for students in New Mexico. Welcome everyone to this conversation. As you all know, in recent years, especially in this post-pandemic world, reports about education have been quite grim. As you know, in recent years, this is happening, and COVID didn't quite help. Last month, the nation's report card revealed that nationally, just 33% of fourth graders and only 31% of eighth graders were deemed proficient or better in reading. The math scores are equally as disturbing. Statistics like these are closely tied to students dropping out of high school, and for many, dropping out leads to a vicious cycle of unemployment, poverty, debt, poor physical and mental health, and even incarceration. Over the years, and especially through this post-pandemic lens, the system inequities faced by many communities have been highlighted. Students of all ages deserve an equitable education, irrespective of their economic circumstances, their zip code, their cultural ethnic background, or their physical ability. And these issues can often intersect in an individual's life. We are here today to learn from, be inspired by, and know more about the work that all of you are doing to ensure an equitable education for all students. As a caring community of educators, allies, families, and funders, we want to know how we all support our students. Before we dive into this conversation, however, would you all give us some context about New Mexico and especially the Yazzie Martinez case?
So the Yazzie Martinez decision, we just celebrated its 5-year anniversary, I think the week before last. And while a lot of progress has been made in the state, there's still more that we can do. And I just really want to underline that the Yazzie Martinez decision named 4 student groups that have been underserved in public education: special education students, students who come from families from low economic backgrounds, bilingual students, and indigenous students. And so those 4 student groups especially are named in that lawsuit. And so lots of efforts have gone on across the state, and still more should be done. And, you know, in conversation before this meeting, we were talking about how this decision and where we are now is not the fault of teachers in the classroom or even school or district administrators. Everyone is doing their absolute best to serve young people in the best way that they know how. And it's the systems to support teachers to understand cultural relevance and engaging in their own experiences and serving young people of color in our state or students with special education services. And And certainly that's also true for school and district leaders. And so just thinking about the decision, not in terms of individuals, but in and the systems of support across the state and how those can be de-siloed and brought together, like for all of us here today, in order to make this change across the state.
She pretty much covered it. And I know the work we're doing with New Mexico UDL helps to go in to support the needs so that we're working with all students, not just focused on a particular population. And so with the Yazzie Martinez case, that has been part of it. And so we, all the work that New Mexico UDL does is we try to braid together the initiatives that are in the state. So we try to bring together special ed, regular ed, a focus on SEL, a focus on structured literacy, bringing in the math, bringing in social studies, bringing in CTE. So really when you view through the lens of Universal Design for Learning or UDL, you're really giving those students a voice and building student agency with that. And so that partners nicely with the work that everybody's trying to do in the state. Do you have anything to add, Kitty?
No. I don't know how to really add on top of that. Those are all really good points, and the overall situation and circumstance that we're looking to help in New Mexico.
Well, and I think Bookshare is a vital part of that as well, because when students have access to digital books through Bookshare, we almost level that playing field as well. So it doesn't matter if they have a disability or not. I know that there's specific criteria to meet for Bookshare, but with Bookshare, I know we've worked, I personally have worked with Sarah and Benetect probably for the majority of my career to get Bookshare in the hands of our students here. So that's been one way that we've removed that barrier of access through getting students in Bookshare so that they can access the curriculum.
All right, well, my first question is for you, Lisa. Is that this is something that Future Focus Education is trying to change, and you're working to support Indigenous communities and their languages in New Mexico. Can you tell us about the work that you're doing there?
Yeah, thank you for asking. Future Focus Education is a nonprofit that's based here in Albuquerque, and we partner with schools and districts across the state. And we do work in Indigenous communities. That's not the entire focus of our organization, but given the populations named in Yazzie Martinez, which is really foundational for all of our work, it's especially important to us to see that they're served and served well. But Future Focus Education works to establish partnerships, community partnerships with schools and the community and nonprofit organizations in their communities in order to create authentic learning and assessment opportunities, such as a capstone. The capstone initiative is something that I have had the opportunity and the good fortune to lead in New Mexico for the last few years. And then also internships is another part of what our organization does to provide young people authentic learning in the community so that they develop an identity then and a role and responsibility in their community so that they're less likely to leave. And so our organization also talks about community well-being and student well-being. And then all of this and integrated in all of this is social emotional learning and trauma-informed practices. And so all of my colleagues, we work together to move this kind of authentic community-based learning forward in the state. And also really just centering young people and their local context and local wisdom is having value more than anything else.
Great, and that's amazing work that you all are doing. I understand that you have a personal story that inspires you to do this work. Do you mind sharing that with the rest of us?
Yeah, thank you. So as I shared, we've had the opportunity to work with schools and districts around the state, and in particular, the Capstone Initiative. We work to help schools and districts create graduate profiles, which are which name outcomes for graduates, knowledge, skills, and attributes that are informed by the community, teachers, and students. And that document then guides the Capstone learning and assessment experience. And so in Zuni, they created their graduate profile. Even through the pandemic, they did it. They really pushed hard, the team at Zuni High School, and created the graduate profile for Zuni Public Schools. And their capstone started in a dual credit class, which was for, you know, college going students, really high performing students in their high school. And what they've done over the years is to make that more accessible for all students. And so now their capstone is situated in their English 12 class. It counts for graduation, and they do community research. So they identify an issue or a concern to begin, the class does. Then they work collectively because that's part of their culture. And they work to find a solution or a product for their question that they start with. And they do that through community research and interviews and different kinds of research tactics. And then they have the exhibition at the end of the year. And so there's one story that I think is really powerful, in particular this last school year. So as I shared, it started in the dual credit class, and now it's across the school. And their special education class, their English 12 special education class, it had the same exact presentation, went through the same exact process as every other student on campus. And so when you think about education without barriers, but with modifications, so that young people have access to the same kind of learning and rigor and experiences as their peers, all students, I think Zuni's a really good example of that. And it's that particular experience, I might get emotional because I usually do when I talk about this, because it's just so deeply moving. But that particular group, they researched indigenous games, the games that are historical to their community. The issue that they identified was that young people have become distanced from their community because of the pandemic. They're on their phones. And so they found that games could be a solution. And so this group created one of the traditional games as a board game, and their board members were there to evaluate their exhibition of learning. And it made me so proud of them. They were like correcting the adults in the room where to put pieces, and they couldn't move that there. And they just took like so much ownership over that experience and had so much pride. And then at the end of that, when the board members went outside to score, they came back in and announced that they had passed based on their graduate profile. The assessment was their graduate profile. They like hooped and hollered and literally jumped for joy and were hugging and just like had so much joy. And I just think for assessment that counts for graduation, having so much joy that's a really new experience, I think. And I think, you know, from that, we can learn a lot from what's happening in Zuni. Thank you for asking.
Oh, no, that's amazing. And you know, I know that everyone on the call probably wants to hear more. Thank you, though. You shared a wonderful video about this. So we're going to show a short snippet of the highlights of the story that you just shared.
We work as a collective. And that is critical to us as Indigenous people, because it's never been about the I. And so particularly with the Oshawi core values, and where we will help one another, we will listen to one another, we will provide guidance and counsel to one another. So they wanted to create a class, and they actually wrote a whole curriculum for this class along with a website, so that there could be a class here for Zuni students to create their own regalia and then take that power with them and then be able to then, you know, pass that on to generations.
Wait, let me get Kristen. This might be... Wait, Kristen, look.
I would rather set my own goals and expectations and take initiative to develop my own project rather than have someone come in and give me these numbers and prompts that have no connection to my identity or culture.
Thank you again, Lisa, for sharing that great video with us. All right. So, you know, you talked a lot about the work that you're doing. What impact are these initiatives having on students, families, and the community?
Thank you. That's such a complex question. I've spent quite a bit of time thinking about how to answer it. One, I think it's that, you know, capstones we saw in the short clip and what I just described, it's not just culturally relevant, it's also culturally affirming and sustaining, that those young people are guiding their own learning in a way that's meaningful to their community, and it's in the community. So I think that's an important outcome. It makes the learning transparent to the community because they come to the exhibition of learning. The students are asking such huge, important questions that have implications for their community and not just their own education. You know, the other more pragmatic answer probably is that student disengagement is really high across the country, but here in New Mexico, in our metro area, we have the highest rate of disengagement in the entire country for students 14 to 24. I mean, it's huge. And so we're really in a crisis. And when you think about the kind of learning that you saw in that short clip, that it becomes more than just book work really for them. It's really meaningful and impactful for them, for their families. And I think that has such, that's really needed right now. You know, and in that video too, one of my colleagues, Ronnie, says, you know, when students ask him, well, when am I going to use this? You know, right? Like, I remember asking that when I was in algebra one, like, you know, like, when am I going to really use this? And he can say in his capstone class, right now, you're using it right now at this moment, this is it. And so I just think that kind of relevance and opportunity is so engaging for young people. We've seen that's also true in our internship program. We still serve young people who've been pushed out of larger public schools and didn't find their fit there, which is fair, right? Like, everybody has a different way of learning. And that through the internships, you know, these students that were seen as unsuccessful in other contexts are really successful with employers. They're offered jobs at the end of their internships. And so, you know, authentic learning experiences like internships become another way to re-engage young people. And also, I'll just say, we're having an educator summit at the end of this month on August 26th to learn more about internships, work-based learning, and in particular capstones and this other way of facilitating learning as an educator and assessing learning in a way with the community. And so I think there might be a resource shared in the chat that includes that registration link, but it's free to all educators in New Mexico, and we invite anyone to attend.
Great. Thank you. And thank you for talking about how it's not, you know, it's not just one thing. The community is a big piece of how kids are learning and accessing information. You know, a lot of the work that Sarah, you're doing in Albuquerque highlights the community as well as the schools. Can you tell us a little bit about the work you're doing to further the mission of, you know, how do we grow this kind of program? How do we grow access to information in Albuquerque?
Yeah, definitely. So what my position is I work with Bookshare, and we're providing an accessible resource for students who need alternative needs for their learning. So a big part of that is not just having the resource that is a screen reader or a web library that's available to customize for their students, is we also have to have relevant content. So part of what I've been doing here in Albuquerque is ensuring and working to build that collection that we have, and making sure that for some of the tribal schools I've worked with, we're making sure we have the books that are in their curriculum in our library, and the ones that we don't have, we're working to acquire. But another step to that, that is kind of a bigger project we're working on right now, is a lot of the indigenous languages here in New Mexico and kind of, you know, all over the United States are a spoken language. So it's not a written language per se, or one that is going to be easily accessible or have the correct pronunciation if it's used the AI voice. And we're looking on how we can acquire human narrated versions of their language or their text, so that we are able to provide for these students that we're wanting to just the equity of their education and giving them the quality, culturally relevant content. And that goes not just with like the indigenous languages here. We also work to support that throughout the nation and internationally, is to make sure we have relevant content that's going to actually reach the student. Like, we built book collections in Farsi and Hebrew. I think there's over 70 languages that we support through Bookshare. And that's just a big part of what we're doing.
Great. Thanks, Sarah. Janae, I have a question for you. So at the heart of both of our organizations, we have a mission to ensure that individuals with reading barriers are able to receive an equitable education. Can you tell us a little bit about how the New Mexico UDL is handling that?
Absolutely, I would love to. So we are a whole 3 years strong going for New Mexico UDL, but UDL is not something new. It's just being highlighted more.
So what we're doing is we don't use the word initiative in our work. We talk about project. For some reason, initiative seems to scare everybody away and they're like, oh, it's just gonna be a drive-by, we're done with you. So we talk about the New Mexico UDL project. In that, districts get to join us for an entire year of support and they get to choose to sign up. And in keeping with the true fashion of UDL, we work side by side with that district. We talk about what they're working on, what that district's vision is, what their goals are, how we can support them. And in that year, we also provide 4 pieces of software. So we provide a reading support, which is Snap and Read Universal. We provide a writing support, which is Co-Writer Universal. We provide a math support, which is Equatio. And then the last piece we provide, we love to call it, we don't like to talk about assessment, but we call it a fact finder or an empowerment tool, but it's the UPAR Universal. And what it does in 15 minutes, we figure out how students learn best. Do they read best with their eyes or do they read best with their ears? And then from that, we determine how Snap and Read then supports them in their work. And so the work we're doing is we view everything through the lens of UDL. We work with from the top down and the bottom up. So we meet with superintendents, principals, teachers, and then we also work with the students. We're really working to build in voice and choice without entitlement. So we want these students to be able to build that student agency, build the ability to advocate for the needs, but also take away that negative connotation of like, I'm cheating because I'm using these tools, or I take away that barrier of access. So my hope is that when districts join us, that they join us for 3 years so that we build that strong foundation in the 3 years. So the first year we have with them, we're really building that foundational piece of here's the tools, here's how we use it. I have 18 schools or 18 districts currently now who are in year 2 of support with us. And so we are building, going in and working in lesson planning, diving deeper into what they're doing. We're braiding in some of the other pieces that the state has added. So we're trying to show them that in the state of New Mexico, we work on MLSS. In other states, they call it MTSS. So it's a multi-layer system of support. So we're trying to braid that into the lens of UDL, braiding in structured literacy, bringing in Bookshare, bringing in the math components, the reading, writing, all of that. So we're really working on voice. And then the big piece that we're building is we are calling them SWAT teams. We're building on the ground in the district UDL teams so that these students are leaders and they have a voice. And it works nice with my new friend here, Lisa, because it partners in getting that student agency and some leadership and having them own. So the SWAT team, it sounds in a negative way, but it's actually fun. It's students who assist with technology. So we're allowing them to be the champion of UDL and take that ownership and be able to share through that. So really when students access these tools, and these little tools pack a huge punch, there's multiple layers and ways to use it. So the student gets a choice on how they get support. Do they want it text to speech? Are they using true word prediction to assist in their writing? Are they able to now really show every step of a math problem with Equatio, where they didn't necessarily have the manipulatives or they couldn't verbally see it? Or if a student struggles with writing, they can actually write on the screen and it'll show the math pieces. They can, so technology is a friend, not always necessarily an enemy. And when you view it through the lens of UDL, you really open up doors. Like I'm sure so many of us now, we're like, oh yeah, we're jumping on a Zoom for a meeting. For a lot of our students, that's a way that they've now been able to have a voice. For us looking at it, I see it as a bag and a toolbox for me with technology and all the pieces that UDL offers. So there's high tech, there's low tech, there's this whole world of AI that is coming into play and is actually going to change kind of the way we look at education. But with the work that we're doing, we are really working hard to give access to every student in the state of New Mexico. So my long-term goal is that every district in the state of New Mexico will have been touched by New Mexico UDL and will have these tools as a normal, everyday piece of their work.
Great, thank you. And so for those of you who don't know what UDL is, it's Universal Design for Learning. And in a minute, we'll see a video that kind of highlights that. But we got a question in that I'm going to throw out to both you, Janae, and Lisa. This is from Jess. It says, thank you for sharing your perspectives. I'm especially inspired by the impact of the capstone, especially in increasing student engagement in their own learning. My work is focused a little downstream in early childhood, working with kids and families prenatal to five. Given the importance of these years in setting a solid foundation for future learning, I'm curious if either one, what projects are happening in New Mexico, specifically for children and families 0 to 5 that you're finding inspiring, or two, what needs or aspirations do you wish were being fulfilled by these early years in order to support the diverse needs of the kids and families by the time they reach elementary and high school? So there's a few things in there for you guys to kind of unpack a little bit, but I can always reiterate the questions if we get off track.
Sure.
That's
do you want to start?
Question. Right. So even though the question was intended for my friends over here. So New Mexico has a really unique birth to three early intervention program that's led by the state. We are considered an at-risk state for birth to three. And so what I think Utah and maybe one other state are the only other states in the country that are also considered this, that kind of operate under this at-risk category. So for birth to three and early intervention here, we do not have to have a pediatrician or other medical person refer for early intervention. If a parent has any sort of concern whatsoever about their child's development, they call an early intervention agency in their area and they get an assessment or an evaluation right away. So that does not happen in most other states, which is already gonna, which already means that our state is serving hundreds more families and babies and preschooler or almost preschoolers than most states do. And then there's also the, in terms of that at risk, NICUs, hospitals, all early intervention agencies, as well as pediatricians and things like that. They also are all very well trained in looking like what is an at-risk thing. So the family's socioeconomic status, a traumatic birth, a prenatal issues. We also unfortunately have a high risk of non-accidental trauma in our state. All of those kinds of things get immediate referrals to early intervention. So not only are parents allowed to call themselves, which again is very unique, but that then also translates to the medical people in the state being very aware of what types of students or families often need early intervention and they get it really right away. That's a really big piece of our early intervention work, but that only goes until the day the child turns three. So I cannot really answer as well for the 3 to 5 part of that question, but I think everyone else can.
So I want to just put one thing to what Kitty had said. So in the early intervention organizations, they work to have individuals from the same areas and same cultures and making sure that it's not here comes your rich white doctor who's going to tell you exactly what you have to do or what went wrong. It's someone who understands the socioeconomic surroundings, possibly comes from the same backgrounds, to make sure that they're giving a more understanding and not judgmental kind of care behind that. But then Janae, you had...
I was going to say, so part of where I'm housed in the Central Regional Educational Cooperative. And we work closely with the preschool programs from the public ed department, but also we have our own early childhood program here that we support around the state. And so we actually just presented, they had a huge preschool conference in May. And so we talked about how Universal Design for Learning can be started as early as 2-year-old, 3-year-old in preschool. When we start to give students voice and we start to give them choice and not an overwhelming matter, then they start to take that ownership. And by the time we can start instilling that at an early age, and a choice could be, would you like to use red or blue, or I would like you to identify the letter A. Can you identify the letter A by A cutting it out of a magazine? Can you highlight it? Can you circle it? Could you make it in sand? So if we start giving them some voice and some say in that and ownership in their learning, by the time they get to say middle or high school, when a teacher offers them choice, they're not panicked and like, do I make the right choice? Which one? I don't know what to pick because they've never given that opportunity. And that's what we're seeing now as our students have been older, that they necessarily haven't had that opportunity to get choice. And they're like, I'm going to choose wrong. So my group, my large team of seven, we are working hard to work with everybody. And what part of my project, we do work pre-K through 12th grade in the work that we're doing with those districts. So we talk about very simply with even with technology, can they hear the name of the letter so we can work on letter naming, but also space. Like, can I choose to sit? It's all environment. Do I choose to sit on the ground? Do I choose to sit in a chair? Can I choose to have a different seating style? Do I necessarily have to sit? So really in blending all of this together, we are very aware. And a lot of my work, you'll hear me talk about braiding. So we really try to braid with early childhood, with social emotional learning, with all the different pieces that are coming from the public ed department, but we also try to work with our community as well. So we offer districts opportunities for families to understand what we're doing too. So universal design for learning is not anything like brand new, but I think we need to highlight it and focus more on really building that voice and that choice with our kiddos, because then it lends itself nicely to the capstone project. Mm-hmm. It lends them for our students to start advocating, like, I mastered this concept, I mastered the skill, and I want to show you it, but I'm not going to show you it in paper pencil because that's not my strength. So we want to play to the students' strengths. We want to find, are they a movie maker? Are they an artist? I have countless samples of students when they were like, this is my strength, and beautiful artwork, and they knew exactly what was going on. They didn't have to do a final exam. They did a puppet show because they could tell me all the historical figures through a puppet show, and it was more engaging and exciting than sitting there taking that exam. And those teachers were like, I knew more about this kiddo and more of what they were able to master when I gave them a choice than by doing your traditional paper pencil.
Mm-hmm. I want to add too, in terms of that birth to three services, it's in the family and the community setting of the natural environment. So kind of going back to the question about, you know, that authentic learning, the early intervention session can happen at the park. It can happen at the grocery store. It can happen at home. It can happen at the daycare, so that those people, the people that are supporting that family and supporting that student, are doing so in that natural environment, which is really the best practice in birth to three. But again, we're really unique in New Mexico, where we have a really strong statewide program supporting that.
I was just thinking about, I wanted to underline and highlight really what was shared about voice and choice and local context and local wisdom. And, you know, we work typically in secondary education spaces, but we did have the opportunity to host an early childhood ed session at our Ed Uprising conference last year. We have another one coming up this year. And what we heard over and over again from early childhood educators is that they're doing the work in the classroom with young people, and they're also expected to advocate for themselves. And so thinking about supports for educators in addition to the young people, I think is another part of the system that just needs maybe a little bit more attention so that they can sustain themselves in that profession, and that they're not really moving in two simultaneous paths, right, of advocate and educator. And I think that's pretty common practice in New Mexico. So just wanted to name that as.
Thank you, everyone. And Jess, thank you very much for your question. Obviously, it was something that this team is very well versed in, and you can probably continue on for the rest of the time. But I do want to kind of keep us moving a little bit. Janae, you shared us a video, and so we wanted to show that short snippet, which really highlights what an accessible classroom should look like.
Grumpy face, usually your eyebrows look grumpy too. Sometimes we need to start with a circle.
Oh, sorry.
Grumpy face. So somewhere you probably need a circle. You need some eyes.
I have to draw now.
You're doing a good job.
No. Do you have grumpy eyebrows?
Yes.
When you have a mad face, a grumpy face, usually your eyebrows look grumpy too. You look mad.
I agree.
Do your mad face.
But I
might need JoJo made whiskers.
Nice.
Okay.
Great. Well, thank you. Thank you for the video. We saw some kids on tablets. We saw some kids on other devices, you know, really showing that opportunity to work in a way that works for them. Right. And not just the one way is the only way. Kitty, this video shows a classroom from the New Mexico School for the Blind and Visually Impaired. Can you tell us more about this video and what you do at your school?
Hi. So, I'm kind of here as the little example of the example classroom in school for all of these projects. So I'm from the New Mexico School for the Blind and Visually Impaired. We are a state school for the blind, and which means that any students that are blind or visually impaired in the state of New Mexico may be placed at our school. So we're considered a placement option on that continuum of services. And so we have two campuses. The campus that was in the video is our early childhood program campus, which is our preschool program, 3 to 5 years old. And so in that classroom were students with a wide range of visual impairments, some that had enough functional vision to access the tablets and drawing on the tablets, as you saw in the video, as well as students with limited to no functional vision using that tactile writing board, which would be kind of considered a low tech. It doesn't have electricity, but when she draws on it, the paper rises up, which is a pretty big accessibility accomplishment really for students who can't see what they might be drawing or writing. And so she gets to produce the same same drawing as her peers that are doing it on maybe on paper, which wasn't shown, but I'm sure that was an option to do it on paper or excitingly on the tablet, because who doesn't want to draw on a tablet in preschool? And then she got to do it there on that raised line board. And so that classroom was a kindergarten classroom. And then what wasn't in that video or what wasn't in that clip is also different types of Braille displays and printed Braille on paper, as well as using the iPads for kind of sharing, thanks to the UDL team and their access to the technology that Janaea mentioned, where they can kind of project what the teacher is doing or writing on the board onto those tablets so that students who don't have the distance vision to see clearly or see well the classroom materials are able to do so on that tablet or on a laptop for older students who are also able to, you know, use that for keyboarding and things. So there's a lot of assistive technology out there for making educational materials accessible to students who are blind and visually impaired, but we also have to think about all the other information that our students are missing. And so our field and profession really exists due to what we tend to call a lack or difficulty with incidental learning, which is the ability to learn through observation or watching. And so, you know, going back to early childhood and early intervention, the second that there might be a suspected or known visual impairment, that family needs support in how to help ensure that that student's difficulty with incidental learning is being addressed, because that is what makes everything accessible. So we've talked a lot about culture and language, but what about just being able to look and see what it is in a room? How many different styles and types of chairs there are that are all a chair and all serve the same function? If we are only experiencing that chair or or cup or whatever common object it is, if we're only experiencing it tactually, how easy is it to generalize? We need our students to have a lot of hands-on, real life, authentic learning experiences from the day we know that they have a visual impairment all the way up through their lifespan to ensure that just that general concept development is coming through, because we can't just read a book or watch a YouTube video about the farm. We have to actually really go to the farm, and we have to go to the farm a lot of times, and we have to go to petting zoos, and we have to do all of these things out in the community, real hands-on experiences, in order to make just the general world accessible, let alone just the classroom materials being accessible. So our school, again, as I mentioned, we have our preschool in Albuquerque, but then we also have our main residential campus that serves grades 3 through graduation down in Alamogordo, South New Mexico. And then again, we have students from all over the state, that some that are actually even flown down to our school down south because it's such a long drive. So we also transport the students, and then they are there overnight for their education to address those needs. And then in addition to that, we do have our early intervention team who supports the entire state, and our state outreach team that mentors vision teachers and teachers in training in school districts. And then we also, lastly, we do have our NMSBVI houses our Educational Instructional Resource Center, which is a federal library program that we can loan, purchase and loan technology, as well as other tactile educational materials to any students in the state that have a visual impairment. And that's just the tip of the iceberg, but a lot.
Oh, that is a lot. That's great. I have one question, Kitty, for you. If you could wave a magic wand to change the existing technology or systems to help your students receive an equitable education, what would you wish for?
I think sort of theoretically, that just kind of came into my mind, actually not on my prepared answer by any means, is actually like societal expectations. We have talked a lot about community, and I think that you, Janaea, really alluded to this as well, of like, technology is not bad. These are all tools in a toolbox. One of the biggest barriers to our students' inclusion in their community, as well as employability, is not the skills or the concepts or the fact that they read Braille, but it's that that just societal stereotype of a person who's blind walks in for a job interview, and can you really honestly give them the exact same opportunities and chances as a sighted person when their resume says the same? That bias that we just inherently have, society. So I think that would sort of be my dream. but part of getting to that dream would be then access to all this amazing technology, these amazing tools, teachers not having to be advocates, teachers getting to be able to teach, these systems, like all of this plays such a big part into that, that societal expectation of our students and of these populations that we're talking with. In terms of like an actual like piece of a like tangible item, I would just say more Braille, more electronic, more access. And so pairing with all these different, again, these different technologies, these apps, Bookshare, all of this electronic content is just life-changing for our students, because now instead of having to spend $30,000 to print a Braille math book, because that is how much one textbook of like Algebra 1 costs, now we can go maybe to Bookshare or to some other like national library service where that book is on in an electronic file. And the newest piece of technology coming out is a full page Braille display rather than a single line. So now all that spatial information of math is going to be available on one device of refreshable Braille, which means we can carry a laptop size device rather than a 17 volume Braille textbook to class. So that's going to be pretty life changing. And that device is like just being produced right now. So we haven't gotten to see it yet. Yay. I know, it's like kind of a really big deal, so I'm really excited about it. But again, that device is totally not meaningful if there wasn't electronic information, because that device runs on electronic, like pairing it with Audible or Bookshare or whatever device that has the text on it. So that's my soapbox. I'll step down now.
No, that's okay. We like hearing the soapbox. You know, we are running a little short on time, so I'm going to ask one final question, and this is to the entire panel. So I want you guys to all, you know, have a minute or two to answer. But if there was one thing that you wish the audience would walk away from this conversation with, what would it be? So Sarah, I'm going to start with you because you're on the end, and we'll work our way across the room. But if there was one thing you would wish that the audience would walk away from this conversation, what would it be?
So I would hope that everyone will walk away from here knowing that every student is entitled to the same education, and it doesn't have to be in that one little box that it's provided, that there is so much more outside of the box that gives the equal opportunities to learning, to information sharing, to all of these things. So you don't have to look at just one item being a make or break. The world is so big and every person is so unique that you can find a way to give that student the same thing you're giving the other student, just in a different way.
Okay. And now?
I love that. And yes, and
I would say we need to move away from what the way we learned and take away our bias as an adult, or because we don't know what the future holds. We don't know technology. Everything is so vastly changing. I can tell you, when you go to most companies now, the traditional interview is not there. So we need to prepare our kids for stuff that we don't know. And that means breaking away from sitting in rows, breaking away from the spelling test. Nobody remembers spelling tests anymore. Using the tools that we have. And that means we're using the tools that it's not going to look the same for everybody, that we need to, it's not a one size fits all education anymore, that students have strengths and we need to pull those strengths and play to them.
Yeah, I would say yes, yes. And I think, you know, most importantly in New Mexico, I think it's important to recognize that the time is now. These things are possible now. Our state, our Department of Education is shifting things away from more traditional ways of learning and expressing knowledge through assessments. And, you know, the capstone can count for graduation now as a graduation pathway. And I just think there's so much excitement in New Mexico around this change that we're seeing happen. And we're in the very beginning of a huge swell that's coming, and it's coming from teachers and from students and communities. And it's really an important moment. And I think also just our work with organizations around the country, they're looking to New Mexico now to learn, how do we do this? How do we educate all young people, give all young people access and opportunity? And I think that's, you know, for a state that on traditional metrics ranks the lowest, those metrics are not made for our students. And so we could never do better than we are doing now. They're not designed for us. And so now the rest of the country is looking for us, looking to us for examples of how to meaningfully engage and educate young people.
Here, here.
It's exciting.
Okay, we'll see if I can top that, even though I kind of already gave my, like, take this away. All right, so this is my thought. One of the mottos that I frequently spout to people in the visual impairment field is that teaching students with visual impairments is not very complicated, but it's not very intuitive either. And I think, and especially listening to everybody here talking and just this general conversation on accessibility and equitability, I think that motto really just applies everywhere. And they're just, it popped into my head so many times listening to these guys talk that I just kind of wanted to end it on there. Like, none of this is complicated.
Yeah.
It's not complicated, but it's not intuitive. It's not intuitive to like search the app store for multi-expression math apps, right? Like, we need colleagues, we need projects, we need nonprofits to help connect all of us to make it all more intuitive. But it's really not complicated, like equal access to education. It's been around for decades, guys, but it's just not intuitive. So,
well, and to say
that,
yes, we would say all means all, like we need to stick with that because all really does mean all. So we want to make sure we have that in focus too.
The one thing I didn't hear you say though, and I just want to reiterate for the rest of the people on the call, you guys are doing really amazing work, but you can't do it alone. And so we need partners, we need volunteers, and we need funding, right? This does not happen because people are just wake up and say, I'm going to do all this great stuff. We need support as well. And so for those of you who are on the call, you know, I hope that you walk away from this call feeling inspired by what we heard today about the great work that's being done and figure out, you know, where your place is in this as well. So I want to thank all the speakers for being here today. This was wonderful. I've learned a lot from you all, and I'm inspired. I also want to thank our audience for their active participation in the chat. And with your questions, you know, it's really from support from people like you that lets us do this work and have this kind of impact. And by providing accessible, equitable, culturally relevant education to students, you know, you heard the panel, we're building confidence, we're improving educational outcomes and future economics opportunities for all of these students as well. We look forward to working with you in Albuquerque or wherever you are based and help in your support for education. Thank you, everyone. Have a great day and we'll see you soon.